One thing that never changes, no matter the decade or even century we're in, is that every company will face roadblocks on the path to success. But as we look to the future, how can we leverage technology to lead through uncertainty, make smarter choices, and even find greater success? To discuss this further, please welcome best-selling author and host Amber Mack, and from CBC's Dragon Den, Michele Romanow.
Michele Romanow, a dragon of the business and tech world, Romanow has found success in empowering others. As a featured investor on CBC's Dragon's Den, Romanow has provided a launching pad for some of Canada's best and brightest entrepreneurs. As a founder of Clearco, a venture capital firm created by founders for founders, Michele has been instrumental in increasing the number of successful women in BIPOC entrepreneurs. And this is just the beginning.
Back out here for a photo
because we matched outfits and coordinated all the Easter colors this morning.
Very coordinated here. All right, Michele, so we have 20 minutes together. We have a lot to get through. Thanks for being here. I wanted to start with this question. I think it's fair to say that every industry in 2022 is experiencing massive changes. This is true of the energy sector, the technology sector, the media sector, the list goes on. Clearco has had a challenging few months. When did you know that there would need to be some significant changes or a reset, including downsizing?
Yeah, so I think, you know, I think about what I was thinking about in January, and it certainly wasn't, we are going to go into a big recession, inflation's going to be at its highest rates, interest rates are going to go up, we're going to have a massive war in Europe, and that would all happen in the span of 6 months. Nobody was thinking about that in January. And so we all made our plans for the year very differently. Last year was a true growth at all cost market. We had VC funding at its highest level ever. Every single company that was VC funded, including ours, was being encouraged and pushed to grow at all costs. And that changed very quickly. And I want to level set why that is. So when interest rates go up, effectively the cost of capital is going up. And so that means if you are a venture-backed company where you are losing money, that's actually costing you more to get access to that capital. Versus if you are a company that is making money, that profit you're making at the end of the day is even more valuable. And so effectively that's what had to happen. But at scale, when these pivots happen, this is really hard. And you know, I have always said being an entrepreneur is an extremely hard job. It is largely masochistic even when the sun is shining. And so when it starts raining and we go into cloudier economic conditions, this is a very difficult thing. And so, you know, I'm just not on stage preaching this, I'm living it. My own company, Clearco, had to go through these changes. We had, you know, anticipated a ton of international growth this year that didn't make sense to continue doing. You know, when the markets turned, it made sense for us to cut some, you know, experimental projects and cut a part of our team, which is devastating for a founder to have to do that. But it's the reality on the companies that win adapt quickly. And even when those adaptations are very, very painful, and even when you have to look at your own products that are not working and your own team and part of that's not working, you have to be, you know, really, really focused on what needs to happen. And I think that, you know, we were no different than anyone else in the market this year.
I've heard you say in an interview that it's really your job to brace for the worst. That is kind of the job of a founder or an entrepreneur. Do you think that the worst is over, or are there more changes at Clearco?
Yeah, you gotta brace for the worst and hope for the best and remain an optimist even when you're doing this job. There has been a lot of parts, and you know, I have a lot of peers that are founders, and all of us describe the last 3 months is probably one of the hardest periods in the last 10 years of our career, right? We are going through a massive economic change, and to answer your question, I don't think we have hit close to the bottom yet. I mean, you just zoom out again at the macroeconomic conditions. We printed more money in the last 2 years than we did, like we printed 40% of the world supply of money in the last 2 years. If we didn't somehow think that was going to have a massive change on what was happening. Like, we're crazy. And you started by opening talking about the energy sector. Like, I think, you know, I would compare the challenges there as tech is experiencing a fraction of those challenges. You know, they're telling people in Europe to share showers, right? These are things that we never thought we would hear of. And so I think, you know, tech has seen the first kind of bump in this road, and it could get a whole lot worse. And the nice part is, like, I graduated into the 2008 recession, and so I started my career learning how to operate in far harder conditions than we had been in the last 13 years. But this is not to say to anyone that this is easy, that this will be a short period of time. And it's a good reminder that, you know, now is probably a great time to be starting to think about starting a business, because there's a lot of different changes happening.
Yeah, we're going to talk about that a little bit later in terms of some of the opportunities that do exist in a crisis. You know, you talk about the energy sector. We know that it is a crisis right now. But let's be honest, when you think about clean tech, there are tons of opportunities that are there if we just go and really seize them. I did have a question for you about how you can support both your team that is going through these changes, but you also have this added layer of complexity, which is the entrepreneurs who you help to fund.
Yeah, I think, you know, as I would give the founders in the room advice, you know, it is really important to be as transparent as you can with your team. And delivering hard news is 10 times harder than delivering good news. And it is still something that I always have to personally work on. And here's what we know, here's the plan that we're going to go. And I cannot promise that things are going to go perfectly, A, according to plan, or that B, things will not get worse. I've been very clear with my team, and when it's really hard, because I don't know how this is all going to shake out at the end of the days. And so having that vulnerability and transparency with your team is exceptionally important. These are the moments when, like, you know, working hard hits a whole new level. Like, there is, you know, moments where I will just have to work for 12 hours a day for 6 weeks to try and fix a problem in a business. And that is part and parcel of being an entrepreneur. I think a lot of people think that this can be a lifestyle job or a lifestyle career. This is a career where you get very little control of your time. And when your business has to respond to macroeconomic conditions, you have no choice but to do that. Because ultimately, as a founder, it all rolls up to you. It's, you know, it's your fault if the market changes. It's your fault if the customers don't like your product. And you have to be very realistic with yourself. I mean, we went back to look at our own product, and we're like, wow, we created some complexities here that are much more difficult than we even have, right? It should be way easier for founders to come to us, give us an invoice they have to pay, and choose to pay it over a certain period of time. Like, wouldn't that be easier than the previous product we were offering? And so doing that level of iteration, even when you feel like you're established, is incredibly important to keep growing. And then probably the last thing is that you have to go back and look at your team. The people that take you through good times are also not always the same people that take you through bad times. And so rebalancing the right group of people you need on your team is really hard and is absolutely mandatory for this period of time.
We're going to talk about the product that you offer in a second, but I do just want to say that there is a fly flying around us, so I don't want to have a Doug Ford moment. If we're swatting something, that's what's happening. We're going to get ahead of it in this conversation. So when you talk about the funding model, you've also said that it is biased. There are issues with funding. As one example, which we were discussing before, female founders get as little as 2% of venture capital funding. I have to read that number over and over again. It
2%.
Seems 2%. The Clearco portfolio is closer to 50% women entrepreneurs funded. How has that been possible to kind of close that gap?
So, you know, I think that AI has gotten a lot of bad press, and it's really sensational because you sell more newspapers writing negative stories versus positive stories. And so there is a lot of stories about how AI can build a lot of negativity. So it does that when you use an old data training set. So if you were to take, I don't know, a classic, you know, VC portfolio and say, look, recreate this for me, of course you would build in all of those biases that previously happened before. And so in our model, we just looked at things different. I mean, the story of how Clearco started was, I was on my first season of Dragon's Den. I saw all of these founders giving up way too much of their company for early stage capital. You know, they were coming on the show saying, I'm willing to give up 10% of my company for the first $100,000. And I said, wouldn't it be better to fund this with a revenue share. So I'll give you that $100,000. Instead of taking 10% of your business that I would own forever, I just want 10% of your revenue just until you pay me back my capital plus 8%. And so that became the first Clearco deal. We have now invested billions of dollars on that model. And the only reason we could do that at that scale is that we had to do things automated. We couldn't hear individual pitches and meet individual founders. We had to say, you know, connect us to the accounts that run your business, your revenue, your payment processor, your ads, and we can see how those convert. And so effectively, because we were just looking at the metrics of your business and using that as the gauge to see how much capital we could give you, you know, that really changed everything. And so this was, I think, Amber, one of the most interesting parts is, like, we didn't do this to eliminate bias. We said, look, these are really good metrics of a business. It shouldn't matter who you are, where you went to school, you know, what even your product is. It should matter, are you growing? Do you have positive unit economics? And do your ads convert at a really reasonable rate? And when we looked back at our portfolio of more than 10,000 founders we had backed, we found that more than half of them were women, a third of them were BIPOC. We've backed 25 times more black women than the traditional venture fund. And a quarter of our founders didn't go to post-secondary education. And that reinforces what I have always known, which is you do not need a certain background or a certain education to be an incredible founder. You need a lot of grit. You need a lot of stamina. You need to be willing to go in that ring and get a black eye and come back tomorrow and be like, I'm back to reinvent something. And that is a far better indication of, you know, if you're going to be a good founder than anything else. So I think it's a very cool story of, you know, how you don't need you know, you don't need to use a traditional approach to do something. And you look at the VC industry, I mean, there's been so many people that have been trying to solve this problem. And we have made, I mean, I think during COVID, you know, founding for female funders went up to 2.8% and then dropped back down to 2%. We've made no real changes in that industry. And so it was time to build, you know, something a little different.
I want to spend the last half of our conversation really focusing on the future.
Yeah.
So when we talk about emerging technologies, you mentioned artificial intelligence. I would totally agree. It has a bad reputation, but it can do a lot of good in the world. Is there any other type of emerging technology that you see that can help to solve the problem that exists right now in venture capital funding?
I mean, I think there's lots of people working very hard, and I want to, you know, take you back to, I mean, I started as a founder out of Queens in 2008, and there was, like, none of this. You know, there is massive tech festivals now. There's massive incubators. There's accelerators. There's early stage money. I mean, when we were looking for early stage money, there was, like, three, you know, VC funds that were really deploying capital in earnest. And, of course, they were looking for founders that had built companies before. And so, you know, for the first 10 years of my career, nobody would give me venture capital, right? No one, it actually wasn't until we had an exit and we sold an app that we had built to Groupon that anyone took me seriously in terms of building. And so I think we have to realize we're in a much better state than we have ever been. All of these tools that exist at the early stage make it truly possible to be a founder much younger and to grow that way. And then I think there's tons more disruption that's probably going to happen in the space, because the reality is like building businesses is always going to be a great business for the financiers.
I think it's also true to say that these are challenging times that exist, but if we look back through history, we see that there have been a number of challenging times.
Yeah.
I lived through the dot-com boom and bust. I certainly know there were difficulties there. So I'm just curious, from your perspective, how can Canada's entrepreneurs who are starting new businesses grow businesses during times like this, during economic turmoil? You mentioned, you know, having that grit and being tough to the times, but what else can they do?
So as a founder, you always have to think about, how do I do more with less? And again, the economic times indicate how you build a business and how fast you grow a business, but I'll give you some examples of, like, the early days that most people don't even believe. So it is, you know, this is my second business. The first business has failed, and we are building an early e-commerce company in Canada in 2010 called Bytopia, which was one of the early daily deal sites. And again, no one would give us money. We started the business by all injecting $10,000 from our bank accounts. So we had $30,000 to start this business on. And that included like building the website, the technology, everything else. And I remember, you know, a couple of things. The first thing I remember is like whiteboards seemed incredibly expensive. So one of the weekends, we went to the hardware store, we went to Canadian Tire, we bought like those big sheets of wood and whiteboard paint, and I remember we made 6 whiteboards for like $50. And I have just never heard of a founder in the last 10 years trying to save money on whiteboards. So the reality is like you can beg, borrow, and steal your way into building a lot of early stage growth. And you're like, well, Michele, you know, an example about whiteboards might not be scalable, but you know, maybe here's a better one. So then we're like, okay, we have this website, we have a bunch of deals, we now need to get customer acquisition. And lots of people today complain to me about, well, you know, iOS 14 has changed ad prices. I'm like, ad prices? I'm like, when I started in e-commerce, first of all, we were teaching people how to buy on the internet. So people would have a 1-800 number they would call, and I remember we would get on the phone with like old ladies who were like, I've never bought something on the internet. We're like, okay, you're gonna download Chrome with us right now, and we're gonna show you what to do, and we're gonna walk you through. And they're like, can I just like read you my credit card number? I'm like, that's actually less secure, but we would do that. And our original way to get customer acquisition is, I remember we had no budget for digital ads, and so we went back again to Canadian Tire. This time we bought a box of sidewalk chalk, and we would go outside every building in downtown Toronto that looked like it had more than 500 employees, and in chalk at night, we would write the deal of the day and, you know, bytopia.ca. I got, guess how many angry messages I got being like, please stop defacing my property. There was quite a few, but I was like, oh, it's chalk, like how angry could they really get? But we got a ton of customers by effectively putting chalk on the sidewalks, which really cost us our time, which, you know, we valued it very little at the moment, and, you know, the $20 box of sidewalk chalk. And so I think, you know, I give those examples because there's always ways to do more with less. There's always ways to barter. There's always ways to get to get to early product market fit by just testing things. And I think it's one of the reasons that we have historically seen such strong businesses come out of recessions. Because when we go into economic turmoil, everything changes. And so we have a lot of new opportunities being created. We have a lot of places where margin can be built and savings can be built that were never being built before. I mean, you think about it, Airbnb, which leveraged a new asset class, Uber, which leveraged a new asset class, deal sites, you know, those largely came out of the 2008 recession because they were all ways of effectively saving the customer money. And so now is, I think, a very good time to build. You're just going to have to build with a lot less capital than is historically available. And, you know, that doesn't mean that capital has dried up entirely, right? I think banks have dried up a little bit, VCs have certainly dried up, and so, you know, options like revenue-based financing is certainly there as people need to continue to grow and scale.
Now, you have always been very upfront about wins and fails. I think I've interviewed you more than a dozen times over the years. It's fair to say you don't have to be here today. I'm sure you have other things you want to do. And one of the things you've said is that you've had to unlearn a drive for perfection. Yeah. And I would love for you to expand on that a little bit for people in the audience.
Yeah. Look, this is a job where, again, you get punched in the face. 8 out of the 10 things I do not work. Just digest that again. Even though people are like, Michele, you're a good entrepreneur some days, 8 out of the 10 things I do not work. That means that 8 out of the 10 nights a week I go to bed, I feel like I'm failing, I'm not succeeding. That is this job. It is really, really hard. And that is the path of innovation, no matter if you're innovating in a big company, in a small company, or if you're a sole founder. And so then what does it take to innovate and iterate? Well, it takes a lot of shots on goal. And the only way you are going to be taking enough shots is if those shots are imperfect. Just think about that. Imagine you like had the perfect moment to line up your shot. There's nothing in the background. There's no screaming. It's perfectly silent. Could you make the shot? Of course, but that's not a basketball game. And so it's a little bit like this. And so, you know, I should make fun of myself, right? I was the kid at a school that was a perfectionist, that never had a spelling mistake in anything, that cared about, you know, the formatting of everything. I cared about excellence, which is what school teaches. Entrepreneurship is not about excellence. It is about speed. And so that means if you were to put this in percentage forms, that that, you know, you should be doing things at 65, 70% and then launching them and then seeing if they work. Because what product market fit is, even when an idea is at 70%, people are like, oh, I still want that. Even though there's a typo on your website, even though it's not quite working every time, you can see that the customer is so interested that they're willing to do it despite the mistakes. And so I had to unlearn all of these skills. I mean, I think this is one of the big challenges facing educational institutions, is that they truly teach the practice of excellence, right? Which is 90% is better than 80% is better than 70%. That is great if you are creating a scientific formula, and it's great for many professions. It is not great for entrepreneurs. Entrepreneurs is about putting things out the door that you're constantly a little bit embarrassed by, and that is a very hard skill to get out there and learn.
We just have about a minute left, and I feel this isn't enough time for me to ask this question, but I do want to ask it, because when we look at opportunities that do exist today, there are a number of emergencies that are on our doorstep. How do entrepreneurs who are in the room watching, how do they kind of seize those opportunities that do exist and just have that clarity that you're talking about to be able to move forward?
Yeah, I think the first thing that should give you a lot of encouragement is most of the disruptors in a single space don't come from that space. Because if you came from that space, you would see all of the reasons why you couldn't do this. You know, a friend of mine, Catherine, started a company called SureTex that makes indestructible pantyhose. You know, there was 50,000, 100,000 people that had worked in the hosiery industry for decades that said it was simply impossible to make indestructible pantyhose. And there she was, buying bulletproof fiber from China, breaking 300 sewing machines to try and figure out how to weave this fiber together to create this product. And she created something that was, I think, truly disruptive to a space and frankly amazing. So the first thing that should give you a lot of encouragement is that you don't need to be in the space. The second thing is you need to ask a ton of questions and be deeply curious about how and why things have happened. And then you have to remember that your first idea probably isn't gonna work. But if you keep iterating in the space and keep learning, you have a real chance of being a massive disruptor.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.